Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Last Gunfighter, Slaughter, by William W. Johnstone with J.A. Johnstone, narrated by Jack Garrett.
Chapter 1. Frank Morgan eased back on the reins and brought the big, golden-hued stallion he was riding to a halt. Behind him, the two horses he was leading came to a stop as well. The big wolf-like cur that had been loping alongside bounded on ahead, though, darting into the brush in pursuit of some small animal Frank hadn't seen. Frank had reined in at the top of a long, twisting ridge that overlooked a broad plain. Behind him was an even broader valley. In the distance to the south and southwest, he saw flashes of blue that he knew came from the Pacific Ocean. "That's it," Frank said to the horse. Like most men who spent a lot of time in the saddle, he was in the habit of talking to his mount. "That's where we're headed, Goldie. Los Angeles." Frank had been there numerous times over the years, beginning when he was a relatively young man, and the settlement was little more than a sun-baked pueblo. Now Frank was a man in advancing middle age, and Los Angeles was a real town. No, more than that, he reflected. It was a city. Streets that looked like a maze crisscrossed the valley in front of him. They were lined with houses and with brick business buildings, some of them several stories tall. Buildings weren't the only things that had sprouted since Frank was here last. Tall wooden structures jutted up in scores of locations, scattered all over the city. They were oil well derricks, and Frank had seen numerous others as he crossed the San Fernando Valley. Nor were oil wells the only thing multiplying around here. Had to be thousands of people living down there, Frank reflected as he thumbed back the wide-brimmed, high-crowned Stetson he wore. No, more likely tens of thousands, he amended. Just thinking about it was enough to give a man who didn't like crowds the fantods. Luckily, Frank was the sort of man who was comfortable wherever he went, from big cities like Chicago and San Francisco and Denver, to small frontier settlements such as Buckskin, Nevada, the place he had left a week earlier. Not that Buckskin was all that small anymore, he reminded himself. It had gone from being a ghost town the first time he saw it to a regular boom town as the old silver mines located nearby began to produce again. Frank had spent a pleasant, if somewhat hectic, time as the marshal of Buckskin before coming to the realization that it was time for him to move on again. Years before, someone had dubbed him the Drifter, and the name fit. He'd been fiddle-footed too long to settle down permanent-like. Besides, the good folks of Buckskin deserved a marshal who didn't have bloodthirsty varmints trying to kill him all the time. A rangy, muscular man with a face a little too rugged to be called handsome, and dark hair shot through with strands of silver. Frank Morgan had been roaming the West for most of the 30 years or so since the end of the Civil War. He had first made his name as a fast gun in his home state of Texas, and that reputation had followed him ever since, no matter where he drifted. The days of the Wild West were fading now as the century waned and a new century loomed in only a few more years. The sprawling, modern city that was Los Angeles was proof of that. It had changed a great deal from the raw frontier settlement it had once been. From time to time, Frank Morgan had tried to change too, but he'd never been successful at it. He was still the same man he had always been, a gunfighter. According to some, the last gunfighter. He lifted the reins and hitched his horse into motion. "Come on, Stormy," he said to the rangy gray stallion he was leading along with a pack horse. "Hey, Dog, we're leaving." The big cur, known only as Dog, emerged from the brush, licking his chops over the critter he'd just dined on. Some unlucky rabbit, Frank thought. Dog fell in alongside Frank and Goldie again as they began making their way down the ridge. The sure-footed Goldie picked his way along the trail with ease. Frank had come to Los Angeles on business of a sort. No one looking at this rugged rider in worn trail clothes would take him for a rich man. But in truth, Frank had enough wealth to rival all but the biggest mining magnates and railroad tycoons. He had inherited half of the vast Browning financial empire from his late wife Vivian. Being rich had never interested him all that much, though. As long as he had enough money for supplies and ammunition as he roamed, he was happy. So he had several firms of lawyers in Denver and San Francisco who managed his holdings for him. He was here in Los Angeles as a favor to one of those attorneys, Claudius Turnbuckle. Turnbuckle had come to Buckskin to help him out there, and when the lawyer had asked Frank to ride down to Los Angeles, since he was leaving Buckskin anyway, Frank had agreed. It seemed that Turnbuckle's law partner, a man named John J. Stafford, had traveled from San Francisco to Southern California to handle a case for one of the firm's clients. And he had run into considerable trouble there. The sort of trouble that Frank Morgan was uniquely suited to handle. Gun trouble. Frank had the name of the hotel where Stafford was staying. That was all he really knew. The lawyer was expecting him, though, and would fill him in on everything when they met. Frank intended to reserve judgment until then about what he would do. Despite the reputation he had, especially among nervous lawmen who didn't want shootouts on the streets of their towns, Frank had never hired out his gun. He sometimes helped out folks who needed his help, that was all. His other killings had been strictly in self-defense. He always tried to turn away the ambitious young gunnies who came after him, looking to make a name for themselves. His efforts were seldom successful, though, and then Frank was forced to slap leather to save his own life. Because even though he didn't want to kill anybody, he wanted to die even less. That was just common sense. The residential streets on the outskirts of town were wide and dusty. As Frank rode along them, leading the two horses, a couple of kids wearing short pants and caps left off playing some sort of game and started trotting alongside him. "Hey, mister," one of the youngsters said, "are you a cowboy?" "Damn, that's a big hat," the other one said. "He must be a cowboy." Frank grinned down at them. "I've done some cowboying in my time," he admitted. "Used to work on a ranch in Texas when I was a youngster my own self."
"Look at his gun," the second kid said. "You ever shoot anybody with it, mister?"
"Every now and then, but only when I have to."
"Are you Wild Bill Hickok?"
Frank shook his head. "I'm afraid not. Bill Hickok's been dead almost 20 years, I'm sad to say."
"Was he a friend of yours?"
"Not really. I met the man a time or two, but I wouldn't say we were friends. In fact, Hickok had once warned Frank to get out of Abilene when the famous pistolier had been serving as marshal of that wild cow town. Frank had gone along with Hickok's carefully worded suggestion, not because he was afraid of the man, but because even by then, he had learned that it was easier to avoid trouble than to seek it out. He was human, though. Human enough to have wondered every now and then how he and Wild Bill would have stacked up against each other if it had come to a draw. Hickok had been fast, no doubt about that. Fast enough to be in the same league as Ben Thompson, Smoke Jensen, Luke Short, Falcon McAllister, and that bunch. Curious or not, Frank was just as glad that he had avoided that particular showdown.
"Wow," the first kid said now. "You knew Wild Bill Hickok? How about Wyatt Earp?"
Frank nodded.
Him and his brothers. And Doc Holliday, too.
Fact of the matter was, he had learned that Virgil Earp was living somewhere here in Southern California now. Frank figured to look him up and say hello if he got the chance.
Were you in Tombstone for the big gunfight there?
Frank shook his head. Nope, I missed that one. If he had been there, he thought, he probably would have sided with the Earps and Doc. They could be a mite on the shady side at times. But Frank knew he wouldn't have been able to abide the cleanse.
Have you ever been in a big gunfight? One of the youngsters persisted.
Probably not any you've heard of.
Aw, he ain't a real gunfighter, the second kid said to his buddy. He probably ain't even really from Texas. Hey, mister, is that a dog or a wolf? The first kid asked,
abandoning his efforts to find out if Frank was somebody famous. He's a dog. Might have a little wolf in him, though.
Can we play with him?
Frank shook his head. That wouldn't be a good idea. Dog had been pacing along, warily eyeing the youngsters, but he hadn't growled at them or ruffled his fur, yet. He's not a real playful sort.
We see coyotes sometimes. They come down out of the hills. Mostly they stay away from folks, though.
Frank nodded. So I've heard. The first kid asked,
Did you come here to kill somebody? I told you, he ain't a real gunfighter, the second kid said, slugging his friend on the arm. Ow! What'd you do that for? 'Cause I felt like it.
A second later, the two youngsters were rolling around in the dusty street, wrestling and grunting and swearing. Frank grinned, shook his head, and rode on. The houses were being replaced by businesses now. Frank spotted a squat, thick-walled adobe building with a sign over its open door that read, Cantina. He wasn't much of a drinker, but he had been on the trail long enough so that a cool beer to cut the dust in his throat sounded pretty good. He angled Goldie toward the building and stopped at the hitch rail in front of it. When he had tied the horses to the rail, he told Dog, Stay, and went inside, grateful for the cool dimness after being in the blazing California sun. The place wasn't very busy. A couple of men stood drinking at the bar. Only one of the tables was occupied. The lone man who sat there lazily dealt himself a solitaire hand. He looked like a professional gambler, but his threadbare suit and old hat had seen better days. Frank moved to the bar and ordered a beer from the chunky Mexican bartender. He left a good space between himself and the two other drinkers, who were dressed like cowboys. But he was close enough to hear the sudden whispers, and when he glanced over, he saw one of them nudging the other in the ribs with an elbow. They both looked at him and then looked away. Then he heard one of them say, Morgan, and gunfighter, and he tried not to sigh. That hadn't taken long. Not long at all. Chapter 2. More than once, Frank had been the subject of dime novels. And while the scribblers who wrote those lurid little yellowbacks usually didn't have much idea what they were talking about, the artists who provided the covers for them sometimes worked from photographs of the novel's subjects. So even though they usually drew him with a sort of menacing scowl on his face that he seldom, if ever, displayed in real life, he was at least recognizable from those book covers. Cowboys loved those dime novels, despite knowing how much hokum was crammed between their covers. Now that he'd been recognized, Frank's hope was that the two waddies down the bar would just want to talk to him and hear about any gunfights he'd been involved in, like those youngsters outside. Most grown men still had a little boy in their nature that they would never outgrow.
The worst thing would be if one or both of those hombres fancied themselves fast on the draw and eager to prove it by bracing a known gunfighter, especially one as famous as Frank Morgan. It was out of his hands now, so Frank sipped the beer the bartender set in front of him and waited to see what was going to happen. The beer was a disappointment, somewhere closer to warm than cool, and on the bitter side, it was wet, and that was about the best thing Frank could say for it. The actions of the two young cowboys were disappointing, too. They threw back the whiskeys they had ordered, and then turned to swagger along the bar toward Frank. He knew the attitude all too well.
"Hey, mister," one of them said. "My amigo here claims that you're Frank Morgan, the fellow they call the Drifter. Is that right?"
If he lied, chances were they wouldn't believe him. He wasn't in the habit of lying, either.
"I'm Morgan," he said without looking at them.
From the corner of his eye, though, he saw the elbow nudge that passed between them.
"Told you," the second cowboy said. "Told you I seen his picture on books."
They sidled closer. The first one said, "I hear that you're a famous gunfighter, Mr. Morgan. I'd be plumb honored if you'd let me buy you a drink." Frank gave them a taut smile. "I'm much obliged, boys, but I'm not much of a drinking man." He hefted the beer mug in his left hand. "This one will do me just fine, and then I have to be moving on. I just stopped for a minute to wet my whistle." The first cowboy frowned. "Well, that's not very friendly of you," he declared. "I didn't stop to make friends."
The second man put a hand on his friend's arm. "Come on, Lonnie. You don't want to horn in where you ain't wanted."
The cowboy called Lonnie shook off the hand as his frown deepened into a scowl.
"Listen, Mr. High and Mighty Morgan, all I wanted to do was buy you a drink."
"I said I was obliged," Frank told him. He drained the rest of the beer in the mug.
"You know why I wanted to buy you a drink?" Lonnie went on.
"Just being friendly, I suppose."
"I figured it'd be a nice thing to do, buying one last drink for the man I was about to kill."
There it was. The challenge that Frank had known was coming. Lonnie hadn't been trying to be friendly at all. He'd just wanted to goad Frank into a fight, believing that he could best the man he considered a washed-up has-been, still living on his reputation. It might have been funny, if it wasn't so dumb and tragic, and so damn common. "I'm not looking for trouble," Frank said. "I've had my drink, and now I'll move on." He had to look up John J. Stafford, Claudius Turnbuckle's law partner, but that was his business, not Lonnie's.
"You're not going anywhere, Morgan," Lonnie said. "Not until you and me have it out."
Frank shook his head, a small, barely perceptible side-to-side motion. "I've got nothing against you, kid, and you've got no reason to draw on me."
"No reason?" Lonnie echoed. "How about to show Barkley here and old Pedro that I'm faster than you?"
The man dealing solitaire, whose name evidently was Barkley, didn't look up from his cards, but he drawled, "Don't kill anybody on my account. I'm not even really paying attention." Pedro the bartender leaned over the bar and held out his hands as he said,
"Please, Signor Lonnie, no shooting. The floor, she is dirt, so she cleans up easy. But it's no good for business when people get killed in my cantina."
"Shut up," Lonnie said. "This old man insulted me."
"Now, how'd I do that?" Frank asked. "By not taking that drink you wanted to buy for me?"
"By thinking that you're faster than me. I can't let you get away with that."
I'm the fastest draw around here, and I'm going to prove it. Hell, Frank thought. Why do they always have to say the same damn thing?
He started turning toward Lonnie, still holding the empty beer mug in his left hand. Without warning, that hand moved quicker than the eye could follow, smashing the mug against the right side of Lonnie's head and knocking the young cowboy's hat flying. Lonnie's knees unhinged. He crumpled to the hard-packed dirt floor. His friend let out a surprised yell and took a fast step back. The young cowboy's hand dropped to the butt of his gun in what appeared to be a purely instinctive move. He froze with his fingers wrapped around the Colt's walnut grips, because Frank's .45 was already out and leveled. The cowboy's eyes widened in shock as he found himself staring down the revolver's barrel.
"Don't draw, son," Frank said in a quiet voice.
As if the Colt had suddenly turned scalding, the cowboy let go of it and jerked his hand away from it.
"Don't shoot, Mr. Morgan," he said, as his face turned pale under the permanent tan of a man who worked outdoors all day.
"I don't intend to if I don't have to," Frank told him. "What's your name?"
"Jeff, Mr. Morgan."
"Well now, Jeff," Frank said, "I'm going to walk out of here, get on my horse, and go on about my business. That all right with you?"
Jeff managed to nod.
"When I'm gone, you might want to help your friend up and take him back to whatever spread you boys work for. I didn't want to hurt him at all, but I figured an aching head was better than a bullet in the brisket."
"Yes, sir," Jeff gulped. "I never even saw you draw, Mr. Morgan. It was like the gun was just there in your hand, without you having to do a thing."
"You tell Lonnie that when he wakes up."
Frank started to lower his Colt.
"All right if I holster my gun? You don't want to try your luck, too?"
Jeff shook his head vehemently.
"No, sir."
Frank nodded and pouched the iron. He looked at the bartender and said,
"I'm sorry about busting that mug. I'll pay you for it."
"No need, senor," the man said, shaking his head. "I'd rather have to pick up busted glass than to have to haul out some young fool's ventilated carcass."
"I insist," Frank said.
He used his left hand to take a double eagle out of his pocket and lay it on the bar.
"For your trouble, amigo."
Pedro shrugged. "If you insist."
The gold coin disappeared with an adroit motion of the bartender's hand. Frank turned away from the bar, adding to Jeff,
"Tell Lonnie I'm sorry I had to knock him out."
As Frank passed Barclay's table on his way out of the cantina, the gambler said,
"I'm surprised you didn't kill that young fool. I was ready to hit the floor in case any wild shots started flying."
"There wouldn't have been any wild shots," Frank said.
Barclay chuckled.
"No, probably not."
He paused, then went on.
"You have the look of a man who's weary of killing, Mr. Morgan."
Frank had gotten weary of it so long ago that he couldn't even remember how long ago it had been. So he just nodded and moved on toward the door. He heard a groan and a mutter of voices as he went out. Lonnie was starting to come around. As Frank reached for Goldie's reins to untie them from the hitch rail, he muttered a curse. He had meant to ask somebody in the cantina where he could find the Nadeau Hotel. That was where John J. Stafford was staying. The confrontation with Lonnie had made it slip his mind entirely. He would ask somebody else, he decided. There were plenty of people on the street. Los Angeles was a busy place. He had just pulled Goldie's reins loose from the rail when an angry shout sounded. Lonnie burst through the cantina's door, jerking away from Jeff, who was trying to hold him back. Frank saw the gun in the young cowboy's hand, heard the roar of the shot, saw Colt flame bloom from the weapon's muzzle as he crouched and turned and dropped the reins. The bullet missed, whipping past Frank close enough so that he heard the flat, slapping noise of its passage through the air. His gun was already in his hand again, and he fired as Lonnie tried to bring the revolver down from being kicked up by the recoil of the missed shot. Lonnie didn't get a chance for a second shot. Frank's slug punched into his chest and knocked him backward into the arms of a shocked Jeff, who caught him and held him up. "Oh, God!" Jeff cried as Lonnie shook and blood trickled from the corner of his mouth. The gun slipped out of his grip, hung for a second with one finger in the trigger guard, and then fell to the ground at his feet. His eyes rolled up in his head, and he went limp. He would have fallen if not for Jeff supporting him. Jeff stared at his friend's slack face, then looked at Frank and said, "You killed him!" Barkley came up behind them. The young idiot didn't give Morgan any choice in the matter. He didn't have to kill him. "That's where you're wrong, kid," Barkley said. "If you're dumb enough to throw down on the drifter, then somebody's gonna die." He looked at Frank, who was already replacing the spent shell in the gun cylinder. "And chances are it's not gonna be an old curly wolf like Frank Morgan." Chapter 3. Figuring that it would be easier and simpler to deal with the authorities now, rather than make them hunt him down later to question him about the shooting, Frank waited at the cantina for the law to show up. "I'll testify that you acted in self-defense, Mr. Morgan," Barkley said.
"So will I, senor," Pedro added.
They were standing outside the cantina by the hitch rail, along with a considerable crowd that had gathered in response to the shots. People stood around watching solemnly as Jeff sat in the doorway with the dead Lonnie's head cradled in his lap. Jeff looked grief-stricken, but he wasn't making any move to try to avenge his friend's death. A short time later, a couple of blue-uniformed men drove up in a wagon. Los Angeles had a regular police department, like the big cities back east, Frank recalled, rather than a city marshal and deputies like most frontier communities. The officers climbed down from the wagon, and one of them demanded, "What happened here?" It seemed pretty obvious to Frank, but he supposed the officers had to follow procedure. Barkley spoke up, saying, "That young fella there with a bullet in his chest tried to kill this gentleman." He nodded toward Frank. "As you can see, that was a mistake."
"See," Pedro added, "he followed Señor Morgan outside and started shooting."
The second officer glanced sharply at Frank and said, "Morgan? That wouldn't be Frank Morgan, would it?" Despite the blue serge uniform and felt cap, he had a raw-boned, sunburned look about him, as if he would have been more at home on horseback and in trail clothes.
"It would," Frank said with a nod. "Do we know each other, friend?"
The policeman grinned.
"No, we never met. But I was in Cheyenne some years back when three men braced you in the gold room. All three of them hit the floor within a couple of seconds of each other, as I recollect. You plugged each of them dead center."
Frank shrugged.
"With three against one odds, there wasn't time to get fancy. I just aimed for the biggest targets."
"And hit 'em," the policeman said. His companion looked annoyed.
"Damn it, Randolph, you almost sound like you admire this gunslinger. I've heard of Frank Morgan. He's nothing but a cheap hired killer."
Frank felt a surge of anger, but suppressed it. Arguing with the law wouldn't accomplish anything, except to delay him from getting to the business that had brought him here.
That shows what you know, the officer named Randolph said. You moved here from Philadelphia. You don't know anything about the West except what you've read in Leslie's Illustrated Weekly.
He stuck a hand out to Frank. Glad to actually meet you, Mr. Morgan. I'm Ben Randolph.
Glad to meet you too, Ben, Frank said as he shook hands with the man.
He nodded toward Lonnie and Jeff.
Is there going to be trouble about this?
Randolph shook his head.
I wouldn't think so. What with these two other fellas testifying that you shot back in self-defense?
Blast it!
The officer from back east began.
Don't mind him, Randolph said with a wave of his hand. I'll fill out the report. You may be called to the inquest, but as long as we know where to find you, that'll be fine.
I'll probably be staying at the Nado Hotel, Frank told him. You know how long you'll be in town?
Frank shook his head. I'm afraid not.
That would depend on exactly what sort of trouble Stafford needed him to handle.
A few days at least, I reckon.
That ought to be all right. I'll talk to Chief Glass myself and let him know the situation.
I'm much obliged, Frank said.
The other officer was still upset and grumbled something about kid gloves, but Randolph silenced him with a glare. He took a notebook and a pencil from his pocket and began writing in it as he asked Barclay and Pedro to tell him again what happened. While that was going on, Frank walked over to the doorway and hunkered on his heels next to Jeff and Lonnie.
I'm sorry about what happened, he told Jeff. You know I didn't want to kill him.
I tried to hold him back, Jeff said. But he was so mad I couldn't stop him. Still, couldn't you have, I don't know, winged him or something?
Maybe, Frank allowed. And maybe I would have missed, and his next shot would have killed me or some innocent person walking by in the street.
His voice hardened.
I said I was sorry, and I meant it. But when you start throwing lead around, you've got to figure that somebody's liable to throw it back at you.
Jeff didn't say anything in reply to that, but his eyes burned with anger. In addition to whatever trouble Stafford was about to ladle onto Frank's plate, he knew that he would also have to keep an eye out for this youngster, impetuously trying to even the score for his dead amigo. Maybe Jeff would have more sense than that. Frank hoped so. He stood up and went back over to where Randolph had finished talking to Barclay and Pedro. The officer patted the pocket where he had put away the notebook and said,
I reckon I've got all the information I need, at least for now. You're free to go, Mr. Morgan.
The other officer still looked like he didn't care for that decision. Frank nodded and said,
Thanks. Can you tell me how to get to the hotel?
The Nado, you said?
That's right. I guess it's been built since I was here last. I recall the Bella Union and the Lafayette hotels, but not the Nado.
Frank paused.
Say, it's not named for old Rémy Nado, is it?
The French-Canadian immigrant had established one of the first freight lines in the area, using mule-drawn wagons to haul goods from Los Angeles to San Pedro and back. Randolph laughed.
It's more than name for him. Rémy sold his mule teams a dozen years ago and decided to go into the hotel business with the profits. The Nado is the biggest and best hotel in the city. 4 stories.
Frank had seen taller buildings in Chicago and Boston, but he had to admit that 4 stories was pretty impressive, especially in a town that had started out with 1-story adobes. Randolph told him that the hotel was located at the corner of 1st and Spring Streets, and added, It even has an elevator.
Well, I'll have to take a look at that, all right, Frank said. I'm much obliged, officer.
You're welcome. You take care now, Mr. Morgan. Having a representative of the law treat him so pleasantly was a nice change, Frank reflected, as he mounted up and rode toward downtown Los Angeles on Goldie, still leading Stormy and the pack horse. Dog padded alongside. The big cur let out a growl from time to time. He didn't like crowds. The Nado was so big that it occupied an entire city block. A concrete sidewalk ran all the way around it. Frank didn't know much about architecture, so he didn't know what to call the style in which the hotel was built. To him, it was just a big, ugly brick box. He left the three horses at a stable across from the hotel's rear entrance. The hostler agreed to let Dog stay there too, while Frank went into the hotel. But he wasn't too happy about it.
"Critter looks more like a wolf than a dog to me," the man said with a worried frown. "He's not gonna attack any of the horses or my customers, is he?"
"Not unless I tell him to," Frank said. "And I don't plan to do that." He handed the hostler a $10 gold piece. "I may be staying here for a while, so consider that just a starter." The man's attitude improved considerably at that.
"Thanks," he said. "We'll take good care of your horses, mister."
"And the dog," Frank said.
"Yes, sir, and the dog, too."
Satisfied for the moment, Frank crossed the street, which here in downtown was paved with cobblestones. Instead of going in through the hotel's rear entrance, he walked all the way around to the front. That put him closer to the desk, so he could ask for John J. Stafford's room. The Nadeau's lobby was full of potted palms, crystal chandeliers, polished hardwood floors, overstuffed furniture, and people coming and going. The men wore suits and looked stuffy and prosperous. The women were mostly pretty and sported big hats, bustles, and flowery, flowing dresses. With his rough, dusty trail garb, old Stetson, and well-used .45, Frank felt a little like a turd in the middle of a plate of cookies. Judging by the sneer on the desk clerk's face, he felt the same way about Frank. "Yes?" he asked curtly, as Frank stepped up to the desk. "Can I help you?"
"I'm looking for Mr. Stafford," Frank said, keeping his voice and expression mild. If he was going to let himself be annoyed by every jackass in the world, he wouldn't have time for much else.
"Which Mr. Stafford?"
"John Jay. You have more than one staying here?"
The clerk didn't answer the question. Instead, he glanced over his shoulder at the board where guests' keys hung and said,
"Mr. Stafford isn't in his room at the present time. Would you like to leave a message for him?"
"You happen to know where he is?"
"Even if I did, I wouldn't be at liberty to divulge Mr. Stafford's whereabouts to a person of your..."
The clerk let his voice trail off and swallowed as he saw the flinty look that came into Frank's eyes. Frank couldn't keep his irritation from showing, and he didn't care anymore whether he did or not. He'd already had to kill some stupid kid today, and he wasn't in a very good mood.
"Just tell me where to find Stafford," he began, then stopped as a voice behind him asked,
"Did I hear my name?"
Frank turned and saw a tall, blocky man with thinning brown hair and prominent side whiskers, wearing a gray tweed suit and a bowler hat. The man's eyes widened. He stuck out his hand.
"My God, sir, you must be Frank Morgan. Claudius wired me that you were coming. It's good to meet you. I'm John J. Stafford."
"Pleased to meet you," Frank said, as he shook hands with the lawyer.
"I was just on my way into the hotel's barroom to have a drink. I've been out visiting my clients, and it's a rather dusty buggy ride back into town. Would you care to join me?"
I'll pass on the drink, Frank said, thinking back to the beer he'd had in the cantina. But I wouldn't mind a cup of coffee.
I'm sure that can be arranged.
Stafford put a hand on Frank's arm.
Come along, Mr. Morgan.
Normally, Frank didn't care for being touched like that. He let it go this time, though, sensing that Stafford didn't mean the gesture to be insulting or domineering. The two of them walked across the lobby to an arched doorway that led into the barroom. Stafford signaled to the bartender for a drink and added,
I'd like to get a cup of coffee for my friend here too, George.
Sure thing, Mr. Stafford, the man replied. Stafford led Frank to an empty table in a corner of the well-appointed room.
Did you have any trouble on the way here? He asked as they sat down.
Nothing I couldn't handle, Frank said with a shrug. He took off his high-crowned hat and placed it on the table. He didn't want to go into the details of the shooting with the lawyer.
Well, I hope that you can help me handle the trouble that I've run into here, Stafford said. I wasn't sure about bringing in a gunfighter, Frank suggested with a faint smile on his rugged face.
I don't know what Turnbuckle told you, Mr. Stafford, but I'm not a hired gun, if that's what you're thinking.
Not at all, not at all. But it's true Claudius convinced me that you might be able to give me a hand with this case, Mr. Morgan.
I'm not a lawyer either, Frank pointed out. Not even close.
I'm aware of that. But you are a man who knows what to do when all hell breaks loose, aren't you, Mr. Morgan?
The blunt question brought a chuckle from Frank.
I reckon that's true, he admitted. Did you come into the city from the north?
Frank wasn't sure what that had to do with anything, but he nodded.
On horseback. Then you must have seen all the oil derricks in the San Fernando Valley as you rode through it, as well as here in town.
Frank nodded again and said,
I did. I'd heard folks had started drilling for oil around here, but I didn't expect to see derricks all over like that.
A grim look came over Stafford's face as he leaned forward and said,
Those oil wells, Mr. Morgan, are the gateways to that very hell I was talking about.
Chapter 4 Frank didn't know much about oil. His son, Conrad Browning, who was the managing partner in the business empire they jointly owned, had mentioned a time or two that they ought to look into drilling for oil, maybe in Texas. It might be lucrative someday, Conrad claimed. But that was just about the extent of Frank's knowledge. However, he couldn't quite bring himself to believe that oil wells were gateways to hell, despite the fact that they smelled a mite like brimstone. He said,
I'm afraid you're going to have to explain that, Mr. Stafford.
That explanation was delayed for a moment as the bartender arrived with a cup of coffee for Frank, a drink for Stafford, and a glass of water. Evidently, the man already knew what Stafford's poison was, because he hadn't asked.
Thank you, George.
The lawyer picked up the drink and took a sip, then closed his eyes in appreciation for a second.
Nothing like some fine cognac to make a man glad that he's alive.
Frank could think of several things that would make him gladder to be alive, but he didn't say anything. He just waited for Stafford to resume, which the lawyer did after a moment.
People have been drilling for oil in the San Fernando Valley on a limited basis for nearly 20 years now. They've been fairly successful. But there was never really a boom until a few years ago when a driller named Lyman Stewart sank a well that produced 1,500 barrels a day. That started a boom in the valley. It spread here to the city when a couple of prospectors named Doheny and Canfield dug a well with picks and shovels and wound up tapping into an even larger oil field. Stafford shook his head. My clients aren't here in the city, though. The boom here is Los Angeles' problem. What I'm concerned with is happening up in the valley.
Frank realized that, like most lawyers, Stafford was in love with the sound of his own voice. He said,
Who are your clients? Our firm represents several of the prominent ranching families in the San Fernando Valley. Some of them, such as the Monteros, established ranches there long before California was even part of the United States.
Ah, Frank said, the Californios. That was the term by which the old families referred to themselves. Many of them had settled here while Spain still controlled the area, even before Mexico had broken free from its European parent.
Stafford nodded. Exactly.
Why did they have lawyers from San Francisco instead of Los Angeles?
Because the Monteros ranch has been here since Los Angeles was little more than a wide place in the road. When they needed assistance with legal matters, they had to go to San Francisco to find it. Francisco Montero retained the firm of Turnbuckle and Stafford more than 20 years ago, and we've always provided him with good service.
So you're working for the ranchers in the valley. Doing what?
Stafford downed the rest of his cognac and followed it with a sip of water.
They're being crowded, he said. Oil wildcatters are moving in all around them, and in some cases actually on their range. The drilling disrupts ranch activities. The excess oil seeps into streams and ponds, and some of the ranchers have even lost cattle.
Rustling? Frank asked with a frown. The drillers have to eat, Stafford shrugged. According to the ranchers, they regard the local herds as a source of free beef.
I suppose a cow might get butchered every now and then like that, Frank said, but it doesn't seem to me like a setup for widespread rustling.
It's becoming more prevalent all the time, Stafford insisted. And the problem is actually worse than that. Some of the riders for the various ranches have been ambushed. Several men have been wounded, and my clients are convinced that it's only a matter of time until someone is killed.
The lawyer looked grim again as he added,
So am I.
Frank leaned back in his chair and took a sip of the excellent coffee. What Stafford was telling him was an old story with a new twist. Frank had seen dozens of range wars across the West, sometimes between rival cattle spreads, sometimes between cattlemen and encroaching farmers or sheep herders. This was the first time, though, that he had heard of a range war between cattlemen and oil drillers.
You're sure the drillers are behind the trouble?
He asked. There have been several out-and-out brawls between the two sides, followed by shootings the next day. No other explanation makes sense.
Frank nodded slowly.
I guess not. What have you advised your clients to do?
Actually, I've been urging them to get into the oil business themselves. Beat the wildcatters at their own game, if you will.
Stafford shook his head.
They're very resistant to the idea, though. I was out at the Montero ranch today, talking to Dolores Montero, and when I suggested again that she consider drilling, I thought for a moment she was going to have me thrown off the place.
I thought you said a fella named Francisco Montero owned that ranch.
He did until he passed away last year. Senora Montero is his widow. She runs the ranch now. And since it's the largest one in the valley, she carries a lot of influence with the other cattlemen, too. If I could get her to go along with the idea.
Stafford sighed and shook his head. But I don't think that's going to happen. She's too set in her ways. That didn't surprise Frank. Most older folks were like that, and getting a mite long in the tooth himself, he knew that from experience. He had tried to break his own pattern of drifting by settling down in buckskin.
and in the end, it just hadn't worked. "What is it you want me to do?" he asked. "I need proof that the drillers are rustling cattle and ambushing the riders who work on the ranches. The Montero spread would be a good place to start, since the bulk of the trouble has been there." "And you want me to get the proof?" Stafford spread his hands. "I need an experienced man who can handle himself. I've spent my career in offices and courtrooms. I can't go gallivanting around the range on horseback. And when it comes to handling a gun, well, let's just say that I'm no Frank Morgan." Frank didn't doubt that. He said, "So what you want is for me to be a sort of range detective for you?" "Exactly. And if I can find that proof you're looking for, what will you do with it?" "The local law hasn't given me a bit of help with this matter," Stafford said. "I suspect that the county sheriff and the chief of police may be in the pay of the oil speculators. If they're not actually being paid off, they're at least being influenced by the wealth of the men involved." "Seems to me like those big ranchers would have some influence too," Frank pointed out. "In the past, yes," Stafford said. "But the amount of money the oil might produce for the area in the long run is astronomical compared to the value of the ranches. The city fathers know that, and so do the local lawmen." That seemed unlikely to Frank, but he realized that he didn't know enough about the situation to make a valid judgment. Maybe Stafford was right. Maybe oil was the coming thing, and raising cattle would fade into insignificance, at least in Southern California. Frank didn't believe it for a second, but he supposed it could happen that way. "At any rate," Stafford continued, "I need some evidence that the law can't ignore, and I'm counting on you to obtain it for me, Mr. Morgan. If you can do that, I'll take the proof to the authorities, and they'll be forced to take action against the drillers." That seemed to be the only course still open to Stafford, Frank thought, as he mulled over the lawyer's words. He didn't have any stake in this dispute himself, other than the fact that he considered Claudius Turnbuckle a friend, and Stafford was Turnbuckle's partner. After a moment, he said, "All right, I'll see what I can do." A smile appeared on Stafford's face, replacing the hangdog expression that had been there a second earlier. "Excellent. Now, about your fee." Frank stopped him with an uplifted hand. "Whoa there, counselor. Nobody said anything about a fee." Stafford's smile disappeared, and a puzzled frown replaced it. "But you've come all this way, and you've agreed to take on a job that may well prove to be dangerous. Surely you deserve some sort of recompense for that." "I agreed to come down here as a favor to Turnbuckle. That's why I'm taking on the job, too. But like I told you, I'm not a hired gun."
But...
Having someone turn down an offer of money clearly had thrown Stafford for a loop. In Stafford's experience, folks just didn't do that sort of thing. Confronted with Frank's level stare, though, all he could do was nod and accept what Frank had to say. "Very well. But the least you can do is allow me to take care of your expenses while you're here. I have a room reserved for you here in the hotel, and I'll pay for it along with all your meals and supplies and whatever else you need."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.